The views and opinions of this broadcast do not reflect the views and opinions of Armed Media, UNU Productions and its affiliates. Enjoy the show. Deviants, it's me, your twisted southern horror queen, coming to you live from under a full moon right here in southeastern Louisiana. Right, can you smell that in the air? Do you feel it all around you? You know what that is? That's Halloween, bitches. The big day is just right around the corner. The best holiday of the entire year, almost here. Can you believe it already? Well, since the 31st is actually on a Tuesday this year, I'll get to be home for Halloween. I've been so excited. I think this is the second time I bought it up. I told you guys last week that I already stocked up on all my goodies. But if you weren't tuned in and you are planning where you're going to go take your kids to go trick-or-treating this Tuesday evening, if you still go on Tuesday evening, because like that is a weeknight and things. Anyway, make sure you pencil in the Gibson compound. I've got all my goodies lined up. I really like to treat my trick-or-treaters, you know, different, more special than everybody else does. And I especially love the 2 to 12 age group. That's the most fun you can have with a kid. Make sure you bring them over Tuesday night if you got kids in that age group. I'm stocked up on super glue and permanent markers, bottle rockets, glow-in-the-dark condoms, and a whole bunch of other interesting little goodies. It's going to be one hell of a haul for the kids and a memorable Halloween for Mom and Dad as well. Anyway, but before the big day gets here, I do have to tell you guys about everything else that I got going on right now, which is like a whole lot of crazy stuff. This week, me, Big Johnny Blender, and the Adrian's Fury Dragster are getting ready to pull out of the Gibson compound again, and we're headed back to Kentucky, Elizabethtown this time, for Night Risers Con. Now, this is a 3-day event, but we're only going to be there the last 2 days, Saturday and Sunday. Day one, you guys are going to love this. They're starting out with the zombie walk, and from what it looks like to me, it's kicking off at Roxy's, and it's going to end up at the Bourbon Barrel. I don't know, kiddos, but it sounds more like it's going to be a zombie stagger crawl instead of a zombie walk. So, I think it'll be a hell of an event. I hope somebody's videoing that because I really want to see it, especially like the last haul of it. But anyway, we're making our appearances on the 28th and 29th. We are on the Night Riser celebrity list along with Malcolm Denair from the movie Christine, Nico Hughes from Pet Sematary. Of course, our friend Tim Shockey is going to be there with the Green Goblin head from Maximum Overdrive. And my naughty vampire Santa, Sal Lazard, is going to be there. And, of course, I'll be there hanging out with Big Johnny Blender and the Adrian's Fury Dragster. And Bill Gibson is also going to show up. He is the proud owner of the Christine car from the movie. Now, I guess you guys have already figured it out. This year, Night Risers is paying homage to Stephen King. As you may have guessed already, Christine, Maximum Overdrive, and Pet Sematary, all King books. And I kind of slide in there in the middle, too. Short and Gory was inspired by Creepshow. Also Stephen King's work, and mine as well. So, it had a little bit of help. I was taking Chanix, and like the Chanix experience was out of this world. So if you're a horror writer and you've got reader's block or writer's block or whichever, hook up with somebody that's trying to quit smoking that's got a bottle of Chanix. Grab two or three of them, take them consecutively 2-3 nights in a row. I guarantee you will have the most awesome nightmares that you have ever had in your entire life. Grab a pen, set it next to the bed, and be ready to start writing when you wake up, because you're going to be jolted. It'll be crazy, I promise you. Chanix. Madness. I want to check in and see who's hanging with me tonight. I see my boy Freddie Roseman's in the house. Hey, baby, how are you? Stacy's in the house. Tanya Heron, that's my cuz. She's over there in Pearl River County, Mississippi. Lester Cole, my heart, was my big friend in high school. His name was Lurch, and he lived up to it in every aspect. My boy, hope you're doing well. And Angela Adkins is in the house, too. How you doing, girl? How's everything up north? Going to come see us this weekend? We're kind of close to where you're at. I'll be looking for you. All right, so now that you know what's coming up this week, I do have one other thing going on that I want to share with you guys. Now, you know that I released my book, Wicked Truth, in March of this year, and that is a badass horror read, so if you're into it and into controversy and pissing other folks off while you're getting your scary on, that's the read for you. You can pick it up on authorlynngibson.com, Amazon, Books a Million, you name it. It's there. Make sure you do that. You're going to need a good read. Halloween is on a weeknight this year. Get a good book. All right. So there is one other project that I was talking to you guys about a little bit last week. I'm going to go into a little bit more detail because I've got an update for you. Now, Spooky Empire was like my maiden, my cherry horror con. And I hooked up there with a bunch of other like-minded horror authors, which that's scary enough in its own right. Well, one of those guys, which I refer to as our ringleader, Mitch Hyman, is the author of Bubba the Redneck Werewolf, who is also in the middle of filming right now the sequel, Bubba the Redneck Werewolf 2. You can pick those up on DVD in Walmart, on Amazon, and pretty much anywhere else you can buy a good horror flick. So check that out if you need something to watch this Tuesday night. Check my boy Mitch out. But anyway, Mitch says, what if I take, six of these other demented little minds that I'm working with, and we start a story, and the first author writes until they're content, and then they give it to a third party, and then that third party takes only the last page of what that author wrote and gives it to the next author who has no idea who was ahead of her and who was behind her, or him. Could have been him, too. And we do this for 7 rounds, including Mitch, and come up with this horrifying book. When I say horrifying, horrifying because it came from our dark and twisted little minds, but it's actually a fantastic read. Now, what we as a group has decided to do is give the proceeds away to charities. And we've all picked our own favorite charities. Mine, of course, is the SBCA because I love my fur babies. But the big announcement, last week I told you if you wanted this book, there was only a few places where you could get it. That's from the collaborating authors. So you could have hooked up with me. However, we are now on Amazon. A Dark and Stormy Night, the Kindle version, right now for 99 cents. You have no excuse. 99 cents and a handful of what we're known as the Dark Alley Crew writers, putting our best and our most gruesome and our most dark thoughts into this combined effort. You guys need to pick this book up. It's going to be a hell of a read, I assure you. My girl Ethel has just signed in. How you doing, my baby? How's things in Texas? Hope everything is cool with you. All right, so now that you guys kind of know what all is going on with your twisted little Southern horror queen, you know what you got to do? Grab that drink, dim the lights, kick out the kids, and lock that damn door, because it's time to get your scary on. So, since this is the last show that I'm going to get to do before Halloween, because remember, next week we'll be driving back from Elizabethtown, Kentucky on Monday night. No way I'm even going to attempt a show. But what I will attempt is maybe to put a few live videos up from the con. So be checking the Facebook page. That is the Southern Horror Queen Facebook page, and see if we're able to actually drop some pictures and videos. That'd be a pretty cool view for you. So anyway, like I said, last show I get to do before Halloween, I got to talk about some crazy scary tonight, right? Well, as we already know, there's a whole bunch of icons that are automatically associated with Halloween, And I'm going to hit on as many of them tonight as I can. First up, of course, a haunted house. So, you ready? Here we go. Deep within the woods, lining the shores of the West Bay Lake, stands the remains of Summerwind Mansion. Now, this joint was said to be the most haunted house in Wisconsin. There's nearly as many legends about this place as there are folks that actually tried to live there. There's so much madness around this house that the locals are still telling some wild-ass haunted tales. Things that they've seen or things that they've heard about that went down there. Now today it's actually in ruins. It burned to the ground after being struck by lightning. But way back before the fire, the house played host to some restless spirits, demonic activity, grisly discoveries, and even a mysterious case of a disappearing skull. Gotta hear this, wait. So from what I've seen, this house was haunted from the get-go. The U.S. Secretary of Commerce at that time, Robert Lamont, was the first owner. That was back in 1916. He used the estate as a vacation home with his family. Well, for the next 15 years, they experienced some crazy stuff inside the walls of this seemingly peaceful retreat. Not long after they moved in, the Lamonts start telling strange stories to their friends and their neighbors. Stuff like things moving around by themselves and noises coming from these empty rooms and the shadows of specters that floated from room to room. Now, the family all agree that there was some crazy shit going on there, but it wasn't quite enough to keep them from hanging out there on holidays. That is until one evening when the ghost of Summerwind decided that they were going to throw a little party of their own. According to a statement made by Lamont, him and his wife were sitting there eating dinner one night in the kitchen. All of a sudden, the basement door flies open. So they're freaking the hell out. They're sitting there watching in horror as the apparition of this massive man materialized from the basement. Lamont actually thinks at first that it's an intruder. So he reaches over for his gun and he fires two shots at it. Both bullets went straight through this looming hulk of a figure. Well, the bullet holes were actually left in the basement door that served as a lasting mark of their time in the home. But of course, they hauled ass the second those bullets went through that scary-looking blob of black that was coming up from the basement. Now, after sitting empty for years, Summerwind was sold in the 1940s to the Kiefer family. The Kiefers also used the house as a vacation home, and sometimes they rented it out to visitors. Most of these tenants claim that Mrs. Kiefer rarely set foot inside that house. She'd usually just hand the keys over to them and leave them to fend for themselves. Well, in the early 70s, the house sold again to a new family. With the arrival of the Henshaws, the haunting history of Summerwind Mansion starts all over again. Now, Arnold and Ginger Henshaw and their six kids move into the house with the intentions of restoring this dilapidated old home. But they couldn't find any local contractors that were willing to work there with them. Everybody already knew about all the mad shit that was going on in this joint. So the family decides they're going to do the work themselves. Folks, as we already know right here on the Twisted Southern Horror Queen Show, ghosts don't like it when somebody starts remodeling their crib. As a matter of fact, it pisses them off. So let's just see where this story's going, right? So to start off with, Arnold discovers a hidden crawl space while he's painting a bedroom closet. Get this. He's too big to fit inside, so this asshat sends his youngest daughter, Mary, in to investigate. Yeah. So inside this hidden room, the kid finds a pile of bones and a human skull with knotted black hair still attached. So they put the skull back in and they sealed up the crawl space without alerting the authorities. So I guess that means they didn't send this kid to any kind of counseling or anything like that either. Mary probably either turned out to be a crack house stripper or a serial killer. So thanks for that, Dad. Anyway, for some ungodly reason, a few years later, they decided to reopen this crawl space. But when they did, all they found was the empty space. The skull and the bones had disappeared. Hey, Brandon, how you doing, my man? Sorry to just butt in like that, but I had to say hey to my boy over there in Texas. Hope you're hanging well. All right, so Arnold's catching hell. Ginger and her kids begin to feel like they're being watched in the house. Then all these unexplainable noises start coming from these empty rooms. Furniture and other things are being moved around without anybody anywhere near them. One afternoon, this apparition of a woman popped up in front of Ginger in the dining room, and it was on. So, like I said, Arnold's catching hell too. He's constantly being tormented by these ghosts. He's suffering from insomnia, and for some reason, he starts taking to playing their old Hammond organ in the middle of the night. He starts telling his family that the music is what was keeping those demons at bay. So Arnold had just about lost his damn mind, and he also lost a job. And then him and Ginger start fighting. Well, finally, due to all the stress of the previous months, Ginger starts contemplating suicide. This entire family was broken. After just 6 months, their hopes of turning this house into a dream home had actually turned into a certifiable nightmare. Ginger takes the kids and moves out to go live with her parents. Eventually, Arnold left too. So now the joint's abandoned, by the living that is, and it's falling into even further ruin. So a few years later, apparently oblivious to all the madness his daughter had experienced in the house, Raymond Bobber, Ginger's father, decided he's going to buy the place and he's going to finish the renovations and he's going to turn it into a restaurant and inn. Well, during the construction of the restaurant, Ginger's brother saw this apparition while he was looking down from the second floor. So he runs down to the first floor where he was lucky enough to witness a residual haunting. That's when a whole scene plays over. And guess what the scene was? He said it was just like standing there watching the whole basement incident as it started from the beginning until they hauled ass out of the house. So, of course, the brother decided he was not going to set foot into that madness again. And he didn't. So Bobber actually starts becoming fascinated with all this paranormal activity that's going on in there. And he starts trying to communicate with the spirits by using Ouija boards. So he was so obsessed that he actually underwent this hypnosis session to help him with contacting them. Later on, he describes what happened while he was under. He told a detailed story about a metaphysical journey to the basement where he found the deed to the house and it had been signed by a man named Jonathan Carver. So Bobber starts believing that Carver was some frontiersman who not only built the house, but also owned, at one time, like a third of the land in Wisconsin. So now he searched the basement from top to bottom, but this deed was never found. Eventually, the project was abandoned altogether, and Bobber went on to write a book in 1979 titled The Carver Effect. It's about all the supernatural events that he experienced while he was there working at the Summerwind Mansion. Might want to check that out, too. Anyway, the house is sitting empty again, at least until 1986, when these three investors come along. They decide they're going to try their luck at turning this mansion around. Well, unfortunately, there was a storm in 1988, and the house was struck by lightning, and it burned to the ground. All it left was the chimneys on either side. And they're still there today. But since then, the haunted legends of Summerwind Mansion have only grown, constantly luring locals and paranormal thrill seekers there to see what's going on. Even though the house isn't there, the grounds are just as active as they've been from the get-go. So now we've got the first Halloween icon knocked off. Haunted houses we can mark off the list. So, what's another famous Halloween icon you can think of? Well, I closed my eyes and thought about it, and the next thing that came in mind was tall, dark, and scary. Not Johnny Blender. I'm talking about Frankenstein! Now, everybody knows that Frankenstein was written by a chick named Mary Shelley. You go, girl. But I know a little backstory about it, and I want to share it with you. This book was actually inspired from a true story. No shit. I know you're dying to hear this. I'm going to jump right in, okay? All right, so imagine this. There's this dude named George Foster, and he's sitting in what they used to call a prison cell in London. It's January 17, 1803. So we're basically talking about a dank and filthy pit with iron bars for a door. It's freezing outside, and it ain't no warmer in that cell of his either. Foster had been arrested, indicted, and found guilty of murdering his wife and his child. He was sentenced to death, and the gallows were sitting outside just waiting for him. Now, there was nothing left to do there but just sit and wait, freezing his nads off until somebody came to take him away. This guy's terrified, right? Here's the kicker. Foster was out of town when his family was found dead, but that shit didn't matter. He argued his case and even had witnesses that swore he was nowhere around when these murders occurred. Didn't do him a bit of good. So here's Foster, an innocent man with a reputation of being a hard worker, a good father, and a good husband, who's going to hang for this crime. And not only that, he's well aware of what else comes after he's hung. Thanks to the Murder Act of 1752, his body would be anatomized, basically dissected. But not before he'd hang from the noose for at least an hour. This was a gruesome event that was attended by the locals like it was some kind of wild street fair. Me and my mind, I could just visualize these filthy little street vendors walking around selling goat on a stick or something. You know, and a bunch of these American Horror Story-like clowns running around the streets to entertain the crowd before the main event. Anyway, the powers that be that made these events like this so public saw themselves creating a deterrent for other criminals. They figured once a criminal stood there and watched what happened to a bad guy, there wasn't no way they were going to act stupid. So I could kind of see their justification in that. Anyway, no doubt the thought of hanging and being butchered probably did keep a few of those deviants in line. But as if the legal punishment wasn't enough, there was more for the sentence murderer to look forward to back in the day. See, there was this whole spiritual dilemma thing then. On Judgment Day, how is a hanged and dissected man going to rise from his grave when his body parts were scattered all over town? Secondly, was the whole scattered thing. You see, once the body was dissected, droves of folks would come in from medical schools and start circling like vultures, snatching and grabbing at whatever parts they could get their hands on for medical experiments and research. Well, whatever pieces, parts were left over would be taken to labs and typically skinned, eviscerated, and then cut into even smaller pieces. Then those leftovers were usually burned or thrown out with the trash. You see, London had a very dark culture that was fascinated with what was known in other societies to be morbid and gruesome. It was seen in their society as avant-garde to perform these bizarre medical experiments. We here on the Twisted Southern Horror Queen show just love morbid and gruesome, though, right? All right, so anyway, there'd even been these rumors that started circulating about some of these experiments where this hanged man would wake up in the middle of being dissected with a room full of surgeons and medical students standing around him. Remember, it wasn't required by law to dissect the criminals after hanging unless they were guilty of murder. So some of these lucky bastards got to experience being hanged not once, but twice before being hacked into pieces. Fantastic. So back to poor old George. He's watching the sunrise. It's his last day on earth. He shivers as he stands to peek out of the tiny window of his cell. The first thing he sees are the gallows. The hangman's noose is already there, waiting patiently for him. It wouldn't be long now before people start lining the streets, eager to see him hang for a crime that he didn't even commit. George was quite familiar with the process. He'd witnessed a whole bunch of hangings himself. It seemed like that was the entertainment back in the day. I would have been standing in the front row too, I guess. Anyway, what he didn't know is that he was destined to birth one of the most bizarre and beloved horror tales of all times. You go, George. Now, from London to Italy, a long time before Foster's trial and sentencing, Luigi Galvani, a noted doctor and scientist from the University of Bologna, sat in his laboratory dissecting frogs. Now, Luigi discovered that if the frogs were touched with a charged wire, they'd start twitching again, and that to him proved that their vitality could be restored. Now, Luigi's work never progressed beyond the frogs when he died. But never fear, his young nephew, Giovanni Aldini, would pick up his work where he left off. Now, Giovanni, he's young and he's got a point to prove. And along with that, he's got a massive ego. If Luigi's experiments had actually worked on frogs, why wouldn't they work on something larger? So folks would start flocking to Giovanni's laboratory to watch him perform these repulsive experiments on cows and sheep and pigs. They would gasp as their eyes would roll back in their sockets and their heads would jerk around from side to side and their tongues twitched and quivered. I'd love that. Anyway, his experiments became notorious and his audience was packed full of the most elite folks from society. Giovanni's ego wouldn't allow for him to settle for experiments on animals. There were bigger and better subjects out there. So Giovanni makes a deal with the hangman, and not long after that, he finds himself hiding under the gallows. Yeah, he was there to pick out the best specimens for his research. He then lugged those fresh corpses back up to his laboratory and immediately started his experiments. Again, the gore-seeking crowds gathered to watch on while these bodies twitched and contorted during these tests. But Giovanni was intrigued with his results, so he starts going around town bragging that his experiments proved that he could bring life back into a newly deceased corpse. All that bragging got his ass in trouble. You see, he was in Italy where the law was that once a man had been hanged for 1 hour, he had to be decapitated before his body was discarded. Giovanni's test had been limited to only using subjects that had been drained of their blood and didn't have a head. So, yeah, old boy was busted, because where did he get the bodies with the head? Interesting, right? So Giovanni packs up his equipment and he moves his ass to London. And this is where George Foster comes into play. Foster's body would be given to Giovanni intact. Now, Giovanni's reputation had preceded him. He starts making these public appearances, and once he's captured the attention of the crowds, he announces that he will bring a dead corpse back to life as the result of his testing. So word spreads, and now everybody's planning on being present for this groundbreaking event. Now, back to Foster. They've come to get him. The cell door screeches as it opens. Foster shivers as he finishes the last of his prayers. He's led down a narrow passageway, his bare feet sloshing through the filthy, stained ice slush that's covering the stone path. His heart's pounding and his feet are numb. He can hardly make it up the steps. Finally, he gets to the top and he's greeted by a large man with a hood on his head. Propped on the railing behind the hangman is an axe, its handle stained with blood of numerous criminals. He steps forward and hangs his head. His senses go numb as the noose is tightened around his neck. Then there's a loud thud, and the floor gives way beneath his frozen feet. Below the gallows waits his transport, ready to rush him to the Royal College of Surgeons. Giovanni's eagerly pacing as his assistants run toward him with Foster's corpse. He immediately starts attaching probes and electrons to his arms, leg, chest, and forehead. He then powers up his equipment, and it's on, in more ways than one. Immediately, Foster's jaw starts quivering. His muscles are contorting and his left eye open. Everybody watching's got to be thinking Foster's just come back to life. So Giovanni continues his test, and at one point, it actually appeared that Foster took a deep, sharp breath. But no further progress was made after that. Now, hours into his procedure, his batteries start failing, and Foster's body is laying there as limp as it was the second he was dragged in there. So Giovanni's humiliated himself in front of anybody who's somebody in London. So he abandons his experiment and goes back to Rome, blaming his failures on the equipment. All the folks that had been there watching go home and start to describe all the things that they saw. Back in the day, gruesome topics were the common parlor talk. They send the kids to bed early so they wouldn't hear all the crazy things that they talked about. You know, kind of like you guys do on Monday night. You put the kids out and lock the door so you can listen to the Twisted Southern Horror Queen. So anyway, one of these folks was a medic that was named Anthony Carlisle. You're going to love this part. Hang on, kids. So Carlisle is invited over for a Sunday social to the home of his friend William Godwin. Godwin's socials were not small gatherings. They were attended by doctors and lawyers and politicians and philosophers and scholars. You name it, they were there. So Carlisle starts describing the experiment in detail while everybody's listening in. Everybody, to include at least one of Godwin's daughters, Mary. Though both Luigi and Giovanni had failed, Mary Godwin Shelley did not, even though it was only in fiction. Frankenstein's character was based on Giovanni Albini, but the monster that Frankenstein brought to life was the creation of Shelley. No doubt that was her vision of Carlisle's description of these bizarre experiments as he saw them. So there's a little unknown backstory to Frankenstein's monster for you. So now that we've got tall, dark, and hauntingly handsome out of the way, on to the next Halloween icon. What do you see? I saw witches. So I do have a couple of witch legends to drop on you real quick. But before I get started, I gotta say this. Brace yourselves. Because of all the Blair Witch bullshit, with a new movie coming out or came out last year, you guys know I thrive on urban legends, but this time I gotta break some bad news to you kiddos. Legend of the Blair Witch, it was created only to promote the movie. Complete bullshit. Sorry, I hate to break it to you. Don't feel bad, though, because I was kind of amped up, too, when I saw the first premiere for the first movie. It looked like it was going to be terrifying. Not so much. It sucked badly. No way I was even going to look at the second one. What's the point, right? So I decided I was going to dig a little harder and maybe I could redeem something of this Blair Witch bullshit legend. No joy, y'all. But I did run across a couple of legends that I think the Blair Witch bullshit legend could have been based off of. The first one is the Bell Witch legend. Kind of looks like a poltergeist event, but the legend itself goes a little something like this. So this dude, John Bell, was a farmer in North Carolina, and he decides he's going to homestead a 320-acre farm in Robertson County, Tennessee, with his family. That goes down in 1804. So the first 13 years were peaceful and fairly prosperous for a new farm, but the trouble started in 1817 when John saw and shot at some kind of weird creature that he saw lurking around in his pasture. Well, after that, the family starts seeing other little creepy creatures creeping around on the property. Then the children start becoming plagued with night terrors. And then came the sounds of knocking and scratching that could be heard coming from the outside walls of their home after nightfall. Wasn't long before all those noises were being heard inside the home as well. It sounded like rats gnawing on bedposts or chains being dragged across the wooden floors. And sometimes it was even the sound of somebody choking. And then came the voices. At first they were just whispers, but as time goes on, those whispers started turning into screams. So things were getting worse. John and his daughter Betsy were taking the brunt of all these attacks. Betsy was getting slapped around, pinched, and her hair was being pulled. And John would suffer with these mysterious choking events. His throat would physically swell, and he said that it felt like there was a stick wedged in his throat. And the folks that witnessed it said that's exactly what it looked like as well. Well, eventually the family had finally had enough. They decided to turn to the community for some help. So an investigation kicks off, and the folks that participated, well, they witnessed some serious madness firsthand. Some people from miles came just to check out the haunting of the Bell Witch, who at this point had gained so much strength that even though she couldn't be seen, she was actually holding conversations with some of these folks, and sometimes she'd even shake a random stranger's hand. So the Bell Witch had all kinds of crazy knowledge about a lot of things that went down in the past and things that were happening in the present and the future. So a lot of the time she'd stand there and answer questions or make predictions for the crowds that would gather around the home. But at the same time, she was still consistently attacking the Bell family. After 3 straight years of endless torments, John Bell was getting weaker and weaker. And finally, on December the 20th, 1820, he died. So, the Bell Witch decided she was going to take full credit for his death. Then she said her goodbyes to everybody that was there, but before she left, she promised that she would return in 7 years, which she did. She shows up at John Bell Jr.'s place, where she had this long conversation with him about her past, his present, and his future. And she even made a few life predictions about how his life would turn out. She left him again with the promise of returning in 107 years, which actually would have been 1935. But a lot of the folks in the area say she never left at all, because there were plenty of ongoing sightings of the Bell Witch and sporadic attacks in the woods around the Red River, right there near where the Bell House was. Second witch legend for you. You guys are going to like this one too. Now, the second legend is about the tale of Moll Dyer. Moll lived in Maryland, just like the Blair Witch supposedly had. But she was known to be more of a herbalist who actually treated and healed a whole lot of families and members of those families in the village where she lived. Not exactly in the village. She tucked herself away on the edge of the forest, just outside the village. Now, she was suspected of practicing witchcraft, but nobody ever really hassled her because she'd done so much good for so many of the people there. But things changed in the winter of 1697. The weather was brutal that year. Food became scarce, and to top it all off, this vicious illness starts running rampant through the town. It's killing folks indiscriminately as it spread. Then the rumors started. You know, some asshat always has to blame their misery on somebody else, so why not the suspected village witch, right? So yeah, Moll falls suspect, and this entire series of unfortunate events was the result of a curse that had been cast on the town by her, right? Not so much. So this gang of vigilantes gets together, and they decide they're going to put an end to all of it, right? Well, on the coldest night of the year, this mob rides out to her cottage and sets it on fire. So Moll runs for her life into the woods. When she couldn't run any further, she knelt down on this big stone with one hand raised to the heavens and the other ones underneath her to support her weight. She brought down a curse so powerful that it absolutely drained her of her life force. She collapsed onto that stone and she froze to death there. Several days passed before she was actually discovered frozen to this stone. When she was removed, there beneath where she had been laying was the handprint and knee print from where she had cast that spell. There was so much power involved that she had actually melded her handprint and knee print into the stone. Oh, and remember, the Blair Witch had this little thing with rocks? I'm assuming that's where that came from. So the stone was actually moved to the front of the courthouse to serve as a reminder, and it's still there today. Now, Moll's imprints are barely visible now, but it's said that cameras are known to malfunction and folks are struck with pain or illness as they come near it. Locals also say that on cold nights, Moll can be seen walking through the woods near town. Perhaps she's searching for her persecutors, or maybe she's looking to renew that curse. Hey, Carol Poche's in the house. How you doing over there, Carol? How's everything in St. Tammany going? All right, so now we've done a haunted house. We've done Frankenstein. We actually did a couple of little witch legends. What's another popular Halloween icon? How many of you guys just said vampires? Very good. I knew there'd be a few of y'all out there. So, we already know that the undead are adored in modern culture. But tales of these blood-sucking creatures go way back to ancient times. Today, we think of vampires and we visualize characters like Eric Northman. But the first tales of vampires originated in medieval European folklore. And there wasn't anything pretty or sexy about them. So let's talk about a few of those early legends, right? Some of them describe these revenants as undead vessels of demonic spirits that resemble this old Norse drog. By the 17th century, tales of blood-sucking fiends spread along with inexplicable diseases. Vampires were quickly established as one of humanity's greatest threatening nightmares. I love them. One of those legends is about the vampire of Alnwick Castle. So you know I'm going to tell you about it, right? Right. The Alnwick Castle was first mentioned in history books in the year 1096. Been around for a while. But the vampire issues, they didn't really start till like the 12th century. This prominent priest contacted William of Newburgh about the case of the Alnwick vampire that plagued his diocese. Now, we talked about Newburgh a few times. He was someone that had been hired by the Queen and backed by the Catholic Church to go and investigate all these reports of the undead. And he kept a massive journal. I'll hit you guys up with some of the writings in there. I think that you would be surprised at some of the people that he has quoted and some of the things that they said. We'll talk about that on a later show. Anyway, legend says that the vampire lived underneath this castle. For over 70 years, he terrorized its inhabitants as well as the surrounding villages. Here's how the story goes. There was this dude from Yorkshire who was, well, let's just say, a true deviant. He was a drunk, a thief, and just an all-around asshole. He was wanted by the authorities, so he hid in the Alnwick Castle where he had allies there. They kind of enabled him to maintain his lifestyle for a little while. So after staying there for a while, he actually starts moving up in the ranks. Because let's face it, he wasn't any more of a criminal than the local authorities, right? So he becomes a lord, and he marries a member of the royal family. It's a perfect marriage, so he thought. These rumors start circulating that old girl's screwing around on him. So one evening, he decides he's going to climb up onto the roof of his chambers and peek down into the window. He sees his wife in bed with another man. So your boy is furious, right? He's so pissed off that he winds up falling through the roof, but he didn't survive the fall. So he's laying there dying, and as the priest runs in to take his final confession, he was mad as hell. He absolutely refused. And as he's laying there, he's uttering curses at his wife instead of repenting and sins before he died. So they bury the dude in the church cemetery. But he didn't stay there. Not long after the funeral, this dude had risen from the grave and started attacking the surrounding villages, leaving a trail of victims with slashed throats and gaping wrists. The population began to dwindle. Between the vampire attacks, the plagues, and the remaining villagers just getting the hell out of Dodge, this town was damn near empty now, right? Well, one Palm Sunday, because the church, they need their offerings, and I guess the priest was the one that said he got to put an end to this, because, all right, skip that. So this one Palm Sunday, the local priest assembled a group of devout residents with some prominent citizens. They were going to the cemetery to put an end to all this madness. The grave was dug up and the body exhumed. When the coffin was opened, the corpse was found up here fresh and preserved. It was bloated with blood, fresh blood. The corpse was then beheaded and dragged out into the town where it was burned. Then the ashes were reinterred into holy ground to prevent his return. And so far, it seems like it's working. So around the same time, remember that's in the 1200s, there's this other vampire legend that's starting to take root. St. Mary's Abbey in Melrose was founded in 1136. It was the chief house of the country back in the day. Today, now it's pretty much in ruins, but back then, the Roxburghshire halls were used to house a bunch of monks and, with them, a 12th century revenant. In this legend, the bloodsucker was a priest who died without confession, which damned him to return and feed on the blood of the innocents. Now, this priest in life went by the nickname of the dog priest or the hunter priest because he loved to hunt with his dogs. Fresh blood, you say? I say it frequently, my boy. But once he rose from the dead, he was terrorized or he terrorized the abbey by feeding on and attacking these poor little monks. Well, the monks were a gentle brood, and so I guess they just locked themselves up in a hall at night and prayed for the damned priest's soul. But one night, the beast took it too far, and he attacked his former mistress, priest mistress. I'm a little confused. Anyway, the monks just wasn't going to let it go down like that. So they organized this ambush, and the following night, when the priest rose from his grave, they tackled him and they bludgeoned him over the head until he laid still. Then they set his ass on fire. When he was reduced to ashes, the monks gathered him up and spread him all over the hallowed grounds of the abbey. The priest no longer roams the grounds in search of blood, but legend says that his dark and looming shadow can still be seen from time to time. Now, you guys know the next one for sure. I'm positive. He's been documented through history as a fierce warrior, a savior, and a king. Vlad III, which was the prince of Wallachia. He was born in 1431 in Targovice. His home was besieged by a conflict because it was wedged in between Christian Europe and Muslim Ottoman Empire. Well, as a kid, he was abducted and he was raised by these Turks, only to return home when nobles ousted and killed his father. That's where his vicious legacy in history began. Vlad was the obvious model for Dracula because of his vicious tendencies in war and his title as the son of a knight, the Order of the Dragon. Dracula, or Son of the Dracul. Hey, Wade, how's it hanging? But there's more to this legend than you're going to read on a Wikipedia page. I did a little digging, and our boy Vlad the Impaler, well, I think you got to find this interesting. Romanian folklore claims that the nights that Vlad and his older brother were born, the holy statues in the city bled from their eyes and mouth. I'm thinking that this was a warning of things to come. But keep in mind, even though the rule of the Dracul dynasty is seen as horrific to some folks, to the people of Romania, Vlad Tepes was a savior. Now, when he died, it was said that the rumors of an undead Vlad Tepes began to circulate immediately. Staff that worked at and lived in the Castle Braun and the Braun Estates reported seeing Vlad walking around the properties at night. After many years of continued aggravation, the Vlad's family finally decided they've had enough of insisting he was dead. They send his oldest son, Menea, out to put an end to all the bullshit rumors. Well, sometime between 1508 and 1510, Menea returned to the monastery in Snagov, where Vlad's remains were buried. When he reaches the monastery, the Bucharest priest forbade him to open the grave. So that only fueled the legends even further. The rumor amongst the Romanian people is that the Tepes family placed animal bones in Vlad's grave. To this day, claims of having seen Vlad on the estate and castle grounds are still pretty common. The suspicion of the undead members of the Dracul dynasty didn't end with just Vlad, though. Even though only a few of his successors actually ruled, most of them had pretty well-respected positions. One of the more popular grandsons of Vlad, nicknamed Prince General the Violent, I like him already, was noted for his horrific tactics in battle. He was married three times, but he never had any kids. Prince Violent was said to have been killed in battle sometime around 1506, but no records have ever been found to confirm that. Another well-respected heir of Vlad was Prince Craftius the Wise. He'd earned his title from several failed attempts to overthrow his Uncle Vlad from the throne. Well, Uncle Vlad had nearly killed him on his last attempt to seize the throne. And when he and his kids disappeared, nobody knew if Vlad banished them from Romania or if they had run for their lives or if Vlad had buried him in a mass grave somewhere. And of course, no records exist on their death. Now, the last of the Dracul dynasty to reign was Captain Radu the Bad. He's believed to have died shortly after taking the throne. Again, no records can be found. He was succeeded by his son Vladislav Carsoni the Bloodthirsty. They were no less vicious than Vlad, that is with the exception of their wives. Six of the women that these heirs, plus Vlad himself, had been married to, committed suicide. Vlad Tepes was the only member of his family that was praised as a ruler. The remainder were seen as fairly evil men. Now, the Dracools were successful in escaping and never having had their deaths properly recorded only added more fuel to that whole undead fire, so to speak. Vlad and his heirs were suspected to be concealed on the castle and estate grounds for many generations. Missing persons in the area and carcasses of animals that were found drained of their blood on or near the Braun grounds were plenty enough evidence as far as the locals were concerned. Then there was another attempt made to end all these rumors. Prince Constantine Serbel had all of the known graves of the Dracul descendants opened in April of 1654. The results of his findings were never made public. Today in Romania, the tales are still circulating. Visitors are also warned to stay away from the Braun and Vania forest, lest they fall victim to some of the Dracul undead. Though this is all quite speculative, the decision made by the Roman government to condemn the Braun estates due to plagued soul only gave new life to the rumors. Perhaps it was an error in judgment that the government stated the cause of the contamination to be due to the massive amounts of bones found on the property and surrounding area. Perhaps not. And then, of course, there's the Blood Countess, who was known for bathing in and feeding on the blood of young virgins to maintain her youth. She started life as a noblewoman in the Kingdom of Hungary, then married the Count Natasi and managed his estates during the war, and after his death, I'm being invaded by Johnny Blender. What the hell did I do? Moonshine. And he hands me the entire bottle of moonshine. What, you want me to drink this on the air? Yes? Okay. I guess we can hold off on Bathory for just a second. Smooth. I don't do it like you, honey. Very good. So, anyway, Bathory was this chick that... Wait, where are you going with that? You can just leave that there. That's... Thank you. All right. Bathory was known for luring these chicks to her estate by promising them work and promising them etiquette lessons and food and board. So, hell, who wouldn't do that, right? But once they were there, they got anything but that. The Blood Countess had three assistants that helped her with her dirty work. They were vicious and sadistic, and one of them in particular thoroughly enjoyed tormenting Bathory's victims before draining the blood from their bodies to hand them over to her mistress. Well, later on, the authorities actually started doing a little digging around. They found out that a priest had been right to accuse the old girl of what was going on. They uncovered hundreds of bodies, which in their eyes represented decades of tortures and murders. Well, the authorities were kind of in a jam because Bathory's political position made her immune to their laws, but that didn't do a damn thing to help her three cohorts. They were tried, convicted, and hanged for their parts in her blood quest. In the end, the Countess was finally walled up inside her home, where she lived another 5 years before she died within her prison. Now, at about the same time as when the Blood Countess was getting her crazy on, there was this other vampire creating a legend of his own. His name was Jur Grondo. He was a peasant that lived in Istria in the 1600s. He's another one of the early cases of vampirism that was recorded in historical records. So he was branded as a Strigoa, which is a local term for vampire. Grondo died and rose again in 1656. For 16 years, this bloodsucker would terrorize his village. His first appearance was to his widow in her bedroom, where he had his way with her. She described him as pale and thin and said that he appeared to be smiling while she was gasping for breath. So she's freaking out about her dead husband, and she runs to the local church where she enlists the help of Father Giorgio to rid her of this unholy affliction. I call that laundry. Anyway, the father starts hanging out at her place, and after a couple of nights, he's thinking that she's got a screw loose or something because there's nothing going on. Maybe she's just lonely. But after a few nights of watching over, the father comes face to face with Grondo. He held out a cross in front of him and he shouted, "Behold, Jesus Christ, you vampire, stop tormenting us." At that moment, tears fell from Grando's eyes and he left the house. He never tormented his widow again. But the rest of the village, they weren't so lucky. Grando plagued these villagers for years, downright tormenting several folks in particular. Well, eventually the locals decided they had about enough of his bullshit. So they had this town meeting, and that included the same priest that had rescued his widow. Father gathered the village's strongest and bravest men to take on the undead. Well, one of these badasses was Mihu Radadik, who was a reverend, or revered local war hero. Well, he had to go with Grando the first night of the hunt. He actually tracked down the vampire. Well, Grando saw him coming, and he takes off through the woods. Radatik chased him down and tried to kill him just by piercing his heart with a hawthorn stick. He failed because the stick would just bounce off of Grando's chest. Well, now the war hero's furious. Nobody ever escaped him before, dead or alive, right? So on the following night, he gathers up 9 of his badass friends, and they go to the graveyard armed with lamps, a cross, and a bigger hawthorn stick. Together, they exhume Grando's coffin, and they open it to find him perfectly reserved, and he's wearing a big, goofy grin on his face. Father Giorgio was brought in to recite some religious incantations while they're attempting to pierce his heart for a second time. The hawthorn stick wouldn't penetrate his chest still. So the priest began to recite exorcism prayers. Then one of the villagers took a saw and chopped his head off. At that, the dude sawing at his neck, the vampire starts screaming and blood starts squirting from the wound. The coffin starts filling up with blood and this headless body's laying there contorting. And then all of a sudden he fell limp and fell back into the casket. Then they were finally able to hammer in that hawthorn stick through his heart.
You gotta wrap it up.
Thus pinning him, now headless and blood drained, in his grave. And Grando never rose again. Alright folks, so that's about all the time I've got for Halloween icons tonight. I'll miss you guys on Halloween evening. Be thinking about me. Have a drink for me. And y'all be careful out there in those streets, because there's a whole lot of crazy folks just like us out there. So until next time, kiddos, y'all keep it creepy, because you know I will. Huh.